Okay, so today's teaching is on 1848 and Marxism, where a few weeks ago, Richard Rubin gave a teaching on 1789 and the left. In other words, the Great French Revolution of 1789, introducing, historically, the concept of the left. Whereas I'm going to be discussing today 1848 as the seminal originary moment for Marxism. So I wanted to start off with a couple of quotations on 1848 from Marxists. I'm going to start with Rosa Luxemburg, and she was speaking in 1918 on the Spartacus program at the founding convention of the German Communist Party in December of 1918, and she's arguing for going back to Marx, going back to the original moment of Marxism, going back to 1848 in particular. So she says, great historical movements have been the determining causes of today's deliberations. The time has arrived when the entire socialist program of the proletariat has to be established upon a new foundation. We are faced with a position similar to that which was faced by Marx and Engels when they wrote the Communist Manifesto 70 years ago. With a few trifling variations, the formulations of the manifesto are the tasks that confront us today. It is by such measures that we shall have to realize socialism. Between the day when the above program of the manifesto was formulated and the present hour, there have intervened 70 years of capitalist development, and the historical evolutionary process has brought us back to the standpoint of Marx and Engels in the manifesto. The further evolution of capital has resulted in this, that it is our immediate objective to fulfill what Marx and Engels thought that they would have to fulfill in the year 1848. But between that point of development, that beginning in the year 1848, and our own views and our own immediate task, there lies the whole evolution not only of capitalism, but in addition, that of the socialist labor movement. Kautsky responded to this, Karl Kautsky, the leader of the Second International Marxist faction, responded to this kind of sentiment on the part of Luxemburg, Lenin, and Trotsky as follows. This is in his critique of Karl Porsche's essay, Marxism and Philosophy. So he wrote in his essay, A Destroyer of Vulgar Marxism in 1924. Kautsky said, all theoreticians of communism delight in drawing on primitive Marxism, on the early works, which Marx and Engels wrote before they turned 30. Up until the revolution of 1848 and its aftermath of 1849 and 1850. This was his dismissal of Luxemburg, Lenin, and Trotsky. So, theorists of communism, they just like the young Marx and Engels before they even turned 30. Maybe up till 1850. All right, so to wit, Trotsky had also written on 1848 in his pamphlet Results and Prospects that was his taking stock, theoretically, historically, of the Russian Revolution of 1905. So this is from 1906. It's from a chapter of that pamphlet titled 1789, 1848, 1905. This is what Trotsky had to say about 1848. The year 1848 already differs tremendously from 1789. In comparison with the Great Revolution, the Prussian and Austrian revolutions, as well as the French Revolution, surprise one with their insignificant sweep. In one way, they took place too early, and in another, too late. That gigantic exertion of strength which is necessary for bourgeois society to settle radically with the lords of the past can only be attained either by the power of a unanimous nation rising against feudal despotism, or by the mighty development of the class struggle within this nation striving to emancipate itself. In the first case, which was what happened in 1789 to 1793, the national energy, compressed by the fierce resistance of the old order, was wholly expended in the struggle against reaction. In the second case, which has never yet occurred in history, and which we are considering merely as a possibility, The actual energy necessary for overcoming the dark forces of history is generated within the bourgeois nation by means of an internecine class war. The severe internal friction, absorbing a great deal of energy and depriving the bourgeoisie of the possibility of playing the chief role, urges its antagonist, the proletariat, to the forefront, gives the proletariat 10 years' experience in a month, places it at the head of affairs, and hands it to the tightly drawn reins of power. This class, the proletariat, determined, knowing no doubts, imparts a mighty sweep to events. Revolution can be achieved either by a nation gathering itself together like a lion preparing to spring, or by a nation in the process of struggle becoming conclusively divided in order to free the best part of itself for the execution of those tasks which the nation as a whole is unable to carry out. These are two opposite sets of historical conditions, which in their pure form are, of course, possible only in logical contraposition. A middle course in this, as in so many cases, is worst of all. But it was this middle course that developed in 1848. In 1848, a class was needed that would be able to take charge of events without and in spite of the bourgeoisie, a class which would not only be prepared to push the bourgeois forward by its pressure, but also at the decisive moment to throw its political corpse out of the way. Neither the urban petty bourgeoisie nor the peasants were able to do this. The intellectual democrats lacked class power. One moment this group followed its elder sister, the liberal bourgeoisie, as a sort of political tail. At another, it abandoned the liberal bourgeoisie at the critical instant in order to expose its own weakness. It confused itself in unsolved contradictions and carried this confusion around with it everywhere, the intellectual democrats. The proletariat was too weak, lacked organization, experience, and knowledge. Capitalism had developed sufficiently to render necessary the abolition of the old feudal relations, but not sufficiently to bring forward the working class, the product of the new industrial relations, as a decisive political force. The antagonism between the proletariat and the bourgeoisie, even within the national framework of Germany, had gone too far to allow the bourgeoisie fearlessly to take up the role of national hegemon, but not sufficiently to allow the working class to take up that role. The internal energy and unity of action, the internal friction of the revolution, it is true, prepared the proletariat for political independence, but at the time, it weakened energy and unity of action. The proletariat actually weakened the energy of the revolution and weakened the unity of action of the revolution, caused a fruitless expenditure of effort, and compelled the revolution, after its first successes, to mark time tediously, and then, under the blows of reaction, to retreat. The proletariat, unorganized, without political experience and independent leadership, followed the students. At every critical moment, the workers invariably offered the gentlemen who worked with their heads the assistance of those who worked with their hands. The students, at one moment, summoned the workers to battle, and at another moment, themselves barred their way from the suburbs into the city. You know, in Europe, the working class lives in the suburbs and the bourgeoisie lives in the city. That's not like the US. Sometimes the students blocking, like, don't go into the city workers. Sometimes using their political authority and relying upon the arms of the academic legion, the students forbade the workers to put forward their own independent demands. This was a classically clear form of benevolent revolutionary dictatorship over the proletariat. I thought that was like a nice, you know, that's still our future. That's still our future, but I'll get to that later. All right, so what Luxembourg and Trotsky were drawing upon, of course, is Marx's own perspective. And so let's hear from the horse's mouth. Let's hear from Marx himself. So he wrote in The Class Struggles in France, 1848 to 1850, this about France. Just as the period of crisis began later elsewhere in France than in England, so also did prosperity The processes originated in England, which is the demiurge of the bourgeois cosmos, England, which did not experience a revolution in 1848, unlike France, Germany, Austria. Elsewhere, beyond England, the demiurge of the bourgeois cosmos, the various phases of the cycle, crisis and prosperity, repeatedly experienced by bourgeois society, assume a secondary and tertiary form. So outside of England, they don't assume a primary form, but rather a secondary and tertiary form. Violent outbreaks naturally erupt sooner at the extremities of the bourgeois body than at its heart. Because in the latter, in its heart, the possibilities of accommodation are greater than in the extremities. On the other hand, the degree to which revolutions outside of England affect England is at the same time the barometer that indicates to what extent these revolutions really put into question bourgeois life conditions, and to what extent, rather, they touch only their political formations. On this, all the reactionary attempts to hold back bourgeois development will rebound, just as much as will all the ethical indignation and all the enraptured proclamations of the Democrats. Furthermore, in 1852, Marx wrote in the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, he said, "Every demand of the simplest bourgeois financial reform, of the most ordinary liberalism, of the most formal republicanism, of the most insipid democracy, is simultaneously castigated as an attempt on society and stigmatized as socialism. Bourgeois fanatics for order are shot down on their balconies by mobs of drunken soldiers, their domestic sanctuaries profaned, in the name of property, of family, and of order. Finally, the scum of bourgeois society forms the savior of society." A few years after this, Otto von Bismarck, Chancellor of the Prussian Empire, said this in his famous Blood and Iron speech. He said, "The great questions of this time will not be resolved by speeches and majority decisions. That was the great mistake of 1848 and 1849, but by iron and blood." Marx would not necessarily disagree with that. Right? In other words, it's a question of whose iron and whose blood. It's a question of what we're going to discuss today, Bonapartism versus the dictatorship of the proletariat. All right, so with respect to 1848 itself, the revolutions that broke out in 1848, I wanted to give some background on the preceding history. So Richard, a few weeks ago, discussed the French Revolution. I'm just going to make mention of it very quickly, and include in the cycle of the French Revolution the Napoleonic Empire, which had been defeated in 1814, but then was resuscitated briefly for 100 days in 1815. So the cycle of the French Revolution, the Great French Revolution, was one of republic to empire. In other words, the absolute monarchy was overthrown, Louis XVI was overthrown. Eventually that gave us the First Republic, First French Republic. However, that republic experienced a great deal of turmoil and collapsed, first in the consulate, then in Napoleon Bonaparte's empire, the First Empire. Let's see what the significance of calling the First Republic and the First Empire is in a moment. After the second defeat of Napoleon Bonaparte at Waterloo in 1815, a 100 days campaign, France is ruled by the Restoration monarchy, And so it's the restoration of the Bourbon same family as Louis XVI. And this period, though it was a very conservative, reactionary, repressive, authoritarian order, it was the restoration of the absolute monarchy, it was under different conditions. It was under fundamentally different conditions. In other words, France had changed. Europe had changed. So the restoration monarchy is not the restoration of the Ancien regime. No. It's something new and different. In the reading group, we read Benjamin Constant, who gives a speech some years into the Restoration Monarchy, I think it's in 1819, where he makes an argument very similar to the argument made by Kant in What is Enlightenment from 1784, under the enlightened absolute despotism of Frederick the Great. Essentially, that despite authoritarian, absolutist, monarchical government, civil society is still free. So the idea is that bourgeois society continues despite the restoration of the Ancien regime. Richard pointed out that the absolute monarchies themselves need to be understood as products of the emergence of bourgeois society. In other words, these are bourgeoisified monarchies by the end of the 18th century, certainly. So that goes
the Ancien regime.
The Ancien regime, right. So the absolute monarchies of Kant, this time, Frederick the Great, but also Louis XVI, are already phenomena of a historical shift that's been unfolding since the Renaissance, but certainly got a great deal of momentum in the 17th and then in the 18th centuries. So the Restoration monarchy presides over, and not only in France, but also the restored monarchies in the rest of Europe, preside over the unfolding of the Industrial Revolution in the continent, which up to that time had been located in Britain. So the Industrial Revolution is conventionally dated. To 1850, thereabouts, approximately, circa 1750 to 1850. The Industrial Revolution actually undermines the Restoration monarchy in France, as well as elsewhere, but particularly in France. And this leads, in relatively short order, 15 years, to the July Revolution and the July Monarchy, what's known as the July Monarchy. Of Louis-Philippe. And he is from what's known as the cadet branch of the royal family. He's descended from the cousin of Louis XVI, the one cousin, the one member of the royal family who was willing to sign on for Louis XVI's execution as a traitor to the revolution. So the July Revolution brings about the July monarchy. It's a constitutional monarchy. And Louis-Philippe Orléans, he's a regicide king, meaning he's basically the French decide, we'll have a king, but only a king who's willing to put kings to death. He's also known as the citizen king and the bourgeois king. However, all is not well. By the 1840s, the Industrial Revolution had led to a crisis. And that crisis is usually referred to as the Hungry 40s, the Hungry 1840s. Many different explanations are given for this. There's the potato famine. There are all sorts of natural explanations given for the 1840s, some climate shifting. That explanation is also given for the discontents leading to the French Revolution in the mid-18th century. Yeah, people come up with all sorts of things to explain why these things happen. But there was a conventional capitalist commercial crisis in the 1840s as well. In the United States, it registers in the phrase the 49ers, in other words, the California Gold Rush of the late 1840s. What would have prompted people to flee the developed East Coast and go west to find gold when most who headed west died en route? The vast majority who went west died. So why were they willing to risk that? Because things were pretty desperate. In other words, that's not usually talked about in terms of American history, but the economic conditions on the Eastern Seaboard were quite desperate because they were so in Europe as well. So it's a worldwide crisis of capitalism. And it's the first worldwide crisis of capitalism after the Industrial Revolution. Towards the end of, right? But certainly the Industrial Revolution had largely already taken place. So it had taken place certainly in Britain. It's still unfolding in continental Europe and in the United States, of course. But not as much in the United States as in Western Europe, as in France and the western part of Germany. So before 1848, there's already a great deal of anticipation of a change. The way that it's put at the time is that they're expecting that Louis Philippe, who's getting older, should he die, then revolution will break out, not only in France, but also throughout Europe. That's the anticipation. As it turned out, he didn't have to die for it to happen, but they were still expecting this to be the case. The other phrase that's associated with this anticipation of revolution and the impending death of Louis Philippe was, I'm trying to remember the name of the statue that they tore down in Paris. It's a statue built by the elephant, yeah. It's an elephant statue that Napoleon had put up, but Napoleon had been kicked out of power before it was completed. So you basically have like the plaster cast of the statue without the bronze being realized. So they say that if it were to be torn down, it would just release all the rats that live in it. So similarly, if Louis Philippe dies, there's an anticipation of revolution, but that's not necessarily seen as a good thing. In other words, all the rats will emerge, which of course is what happens.
Like anticipating a terror.
No, anticipating that all of the contending interests in society will just run rampant. Right. In other words, that Louis Philippe's July monarchy is barely holding together.
Holding the capitalists at bay?
Holding all the various factions. No, the rats would not be the capitalists. The rats would be everybody. Right? Everybody's a rat in revolution, because it's just a free-for-all. All right, so of course Marx and Engels, their famous manifesto of the Communist Party, is written in early 1848. It's written late 1847, published in early 1848, in anticipation precisely of this eventuality of the revolution on the horizon. So what I'd like to discuss is the two cases, meaning the French case and the German case, and how they're related in Marxism thought. So in the French case, we have the February Revolution, meaning the overthrow of the monarchy, which builds up Prior to that, through a series of banquets, these are the form that protests, political protests take at this time, because street demonstrations are banned. So the idea is that instead of having street demonstrations where people give speeches, they have banquets, because they're not on the street, because they're in private spaces, the government can't ban them. But in fact does ultimately ban the last of the banquets, which is what drives people onto the streets and overthrows the monarchy. And those begin in late 1847, leading into 1848, and eventually result in the overthrowing of the monarchy. Initially, the overthrow of the monarchy in 1848, in February, is experienced very much along the lines of the overthrow of the Restoration monarchy in 1830, in the July Revolution. So one thing that I wanted to look at with you guys, just briefly, are some representations. From the history of art, so this is Eugene Delacroix's Liberty Leading the People, which depicts the July Revolution of 1830. Delacroix is a romantic painter. Nonetheless, one of the things that strikes contemporary viewers about this painting was its realism. In other words, it certainly is drawing upon some idioms visually from Greek mythology, from medieval Christian mythology, but doing so in such a way as to depict not mythical figures or spiritual entities, but rather real people. So it might be hard for us to recognize that the woman at the center, Liberty Leading the People, she's not the goddess of liberty, as one might imagine. She's a real woman. And that's indicated by two things. One is that her clothes are torn, and the other is that she's holding a musket. Goddess of liberty would not have torn clothes, nor be holding a musket. So she's a real woman. And her Gallic figure and her facial physiognomy is meant to indicate that as well. She could be, as one critic put it, a fishmonger, a street merchant.
Also her expression.
Oh, yes, yes. So likewise, the other figures are also real people. And they're meant to give a exemplary depiction of what it means for the people to come together in revolution. So you have peasants, bourgeois, workers, you have a street urchin, and of course you have the dead and dying, the victims of the revolution. In 1848, Delacroix was commissioned to paint another painting. Equality was to be the title of the painting. He's never able to execute it. So instead, this painting serves again to represent the revolution. At least up to the crisis of the revolution that takes place, and that is centrally important for Marx and for Marxism, and that is the June uprising of the working class, which is depicted here by Meissonier, the barricade, which again is regarded by critics as too uncomfortably realistic and is in fact highly ambivalent in its meaning. Meissonier is a conservative reactionary, he's a monarchist. He meant this painting to be a kind of cautionary tale. Don't rise up or you'll get slaughtered. But in fact, it was seen as incendiary. It was seen as a protest against the massacre. It was seen as siding with the workers and therefore being a socialist painting, despite the intention of the painter. It was also disparagingly referred to as the omelette of men. The omelette of men.
You want to make an omelette?
Yeah. Oh, you mean the phrase, yeah, it,
you gotta break some eggs.
Yeah, if you want to make an omelette, you have to break some eggs. Which I think that political phrase comes later. Yeah, I think that comes later.
So what does it mean, the omelette of men in this context?
It means that what we have is a grotesque jumble of bodies in which it's impossible to distinguish one from another. Right, but that's part of what people rankle at and protest against in the painting, is that it's
so it's like the
really
opposite
grotesque. Yeah, because you don't have the figures in Delacroix exemplifying different characters, including the dead and the dying, exemplifying and drawing upon a kind of romantic, so you have a kind of semi-pietà image in the Delacroix of the guy strewn along the bottom of the painting. Here, there's no such redemption available. Right, there's nothing redeeming about this revolutionary violence. So what is it that led the workers to uprising in June of 1848? How are we to understand this contradistinction between the February Revolution, which was the beautiful revolution, and the June uprising of the workers, which was the ugly revolution? Well, one of the demands that the working class had in the February Revolution, and which was indeed acceded to by the liberals and also by non-working class socialists, was the establishment of national workshops, in other words, to deal with the issue of unemployment in the crisis of the hungry 1840s. The idea is that if private capital can't employ people, then the state will. So there are going to be national workshops to employ the unemployed, to put the nation to work, public works projects. People think that this is something that's new with the New Deal in the 1930s, but not. It goes all the way back to the 1840s, to the 1848 revolution in particular. However, what the provisional government discovers, of course, is that it's going to be impossible to finance the national workshops. Specifically, British capital. British capital is not going to allow this to not take place.
Thank God.
So they're not going to be able to finance the national workshops. So they're canceled. And of course this means that the working class rises up against this change of policy in June of 1848. So this marks the decisive split between the liberal bourgeoisie and the proletariat, the working class, in the Revolution of 1848. However, the suppression of the working class in June of 1848 is hardly popular. In other words, it discredits the liberals. It discredits the capitalist bourgeoisie a great deal. This paves the way, eventually, in December of 1848, for the election of Louis Bonaparte, who is Napoleon Bonaparte's nephew. to be president of the Second Republic. So in 1848, the Revolution of 1848 gives us the Second Republic. Which lasts until 1851. They have a very liberal constitution in the Second Republic, meaning a constitution designed to curtail the power of the state. One of the ways in which the constitution of the Second Republic seeks to curtail the power of the state is to have a one-term limit for the president of the republic. So Louis Bonaparte is elected in December of 1848, largely with peasant support, but also a significant working class support. He defeats the liberals, who generally favor some restoration of a constitutional monarchy, but they're split between those who want to use the Bourbon line and those who want to use the Orléans line, which adds to the political confusion. But they tend to keep that in the background, meaning they tend not to be forthright about that. So Louis Bonaparte trades on the resentment that has been generated in the course of 1848, and including, and perhaps in some respects even especially, for the working class, the suppression of the June uprising, in order to demagogically take power. So he's elected first president of the Second Republic, one term limit, 4 years, and when it's time for when the new election cycle is about to begin, he does what any rational political actor would do. He overthrows the government. He has a coup d'etat in order to stay in power. And it's the coup d'etat that Marx is referring to in the title of the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. It refers to the 18th Brumaire when Napoleon had his coup d'etat in the original French Revolution. So the Second Republic is replaced by the Second Empire. And what needs to be understood is that not only was Louis Bonaparte popular in his election as president, but he's also quite popular in his coup d'etat. In other words, the coup d'etat has a great deal of popular support.
How historically specific, I'm wondering, is that demagogic, the kind of demagogical character of his rise to power? Is that something you don't see in French politics in the previous decades? Is that kind of a new phenomenon, this kind of mass, the necessity of a mass political appeal?
Well, there isn't really room for that in the Restoration Monarchy, nor in the July Monarchy. There's limited franchise, limited suffrage. What the Second Republic, what the February Revolution issues is universal male suffrage for the first time. I should also say that the demand of the 1848 revolution is a twofold demand. One is for the Democratic Republic, and the other is for the Social Republic. Right? So it's meant to be a Democratic Republic with social content. Because, of course, what brings down the July Monarchy is precisely the crisis of capitalism, discontents of really everyone with capitalism. Capitalism is understood, however, as the rule of the plutocracy. It's the rule of the wealthy who have corrupted the government. And so what they want is not no longer a constitutional monarchy. They want a republic, but they want a democratic republic. And so universal suffrage is part of it. And furthermore, they want a social republic. They want the social question to be addressed. And the social question is the question of capitalism. It's the question of the working class, but also others who are exploited, oppressed, ground down by capitalism in the 1840s. And so the crisis of the 1840s is not exclusive to wage laborers. It's endemic to the whole society. So it's really that gives rise to a new kind of politics. Now, the demagogy of Louis Bonaparte is very peculiar because he kind of says, depending on his audience, he says what people want to hear. So on the one hand, he's complains about the suppression of the working class. On the other hand, he complains about the disorder of the revolution. Right, so he's very deliberately ambiguous about who he's appealing to. He's really appealing to everyone and to no one. Furthermore, he appeals especially to the peasants, and he does so through a kind of patriotism. So he uses his name to appeal to the peasants to say, I'm going to make France great again, like my uncle, Napoleon Bonaparte. So there's an appeal to the peasants. The peasants are, of course, quite discontented. The peasant discontent continues through the period of the Second Republic. The working class is more quiescent in the period of the Second Republic, but there's a great deal of class struggle in the countryside in the period of the Second Republic. And that helps to bolster Louis Bonaparte's coup at the end of the Second Republic and the issuing forth of the Second Empire. Part of the popularity of the Second Empire, the restoration of the empire, is precisely this peasant patriotism, harking back to the French Revolution. So that's the French case in broad outline. The German case, let's talk about the German case. So Marx and Engels are themselves Rhenish. They're from the Rhineland. They're from the western part of Germany. They're part of the area of Germany that's most affected by the changes issuing in and through and after the French Revolution. So they're the most bourgeoisified parts of Germany, the western states, because before the unification of Prussia, that happens later, the unification of Germany under the aegis of the Prussian Empire. So similarly, Germany is undergoing a process of bourgeoisification, however, in the context of capitalism, in the early 19th century, leading up to 1848. As I said, Marx and Engels are themselves the products of not only the culture and the politics, but also the socioeconomics, the ramifications of the French Revolution. So certainly, a lot is made of the fact that Marx is raised by a father who has the family singing French Revolutionary songs in the household. They fondly recall, they keep the memory alive of the French Revolution. However, there's more to it than that. In other words, what you have is a bourgeois intellectual with really very limited potential outlets for himself, either culturally, politically, socially, etc. And so people like Marx and Engels, they join in Western Europe, in Paris, in Brussels, in London, but also in New York, Bohemia, right, which is named, of course, after the Central European province. It refers to Central and Eastern Europeans who flee political repression, liberal-minded, radical socialists of Central and Eastern Europe who flee political repression to the West. And Marx and Engels are precisely that. They're precisely those kinds of characters. So Marx is already kicked out of Germany long before 1848. He's living in Paris in 1844. When he writes the famous economic and philosophic manuscripts, which are sometimes referred to as the Paris manuscripts, that you guys will be reading in the reading group next week, right? Yeah. He's eventually kicked out of Paris as well, and he goes to Brussels. And then ultimately he ends up in London. However, he and Engels do go back to Germany in the revolution. They take an active part in the revolution in Germany in 1848-49. So what happens there in Germany is in some ways a more obscure and in other ways a clearer case. Meaning you have the bourgeoisie rising up with the support of the working class. However, you have literally the question being posed in the context of the revolution, whether the bourgeoisie, the liberals, will confront the Prussian military as a reactionary, counter-revolutionary force by arming the working class. In other words, if the question is really put, are we going to give the workers arms or not? And they don't. And so, of course, the Prussians repress them all. Repress the liberal bourgeoisie, and as well as the capitalists, as well as the workers. So in some respects, it's posed more clearly. However, more obscurely, by virtue of the fact that Germany is more backward than France in 1848. It is. Socioeconomically, politically, culturally. Oh, I see that Brian said something. I'll get to that later.
Yeah, well, that was about the national workshops. You're saying British capital wouldn't finance it, and Brian was saying the taxes that were levied to pay for it were also...
Oh, certainly, certainly, right. Right. It's not just international, it's domestic as well. Absolutely. Okay, so Marx and Engels learn from the experience, both in Germany and in France, that the lesson of 1848 is that unlike 1789 and 1830, the differences among those in the National Revolution are greater than the interest in the revolution itself. In other words, that the capitalist bourgeoisie, including the liberals, are willing to forsake the revolution rather than allow the workers to take advantage of it. And that's true, again, in some ways more clearly in Germany than in France. When I was reading earlier from Trotsky, one of the issues there for Trotsky's Results and Prospects is the analogy of Germany in 1848 and Russia in 1905. I want to make a side note about this because it's important. One of the questions that hangs over Marxism is precisely, is it a product of backwardness? In other words, Marx and Engels as German intellectuals fleeing the reactionary character of the Prussian Empire in the experience of the revolution in Germany, which is far more anticlimactic than that in France. Both fail, but in some ways the failure is more anticlimactic, more disappointing in Germany. It, in some ways it's more spectacular in France, with the Second Empire eventually being its result. The idea is Marxism an ideology of backwardness? In other words, is it a bourgeois radical ideology that's only appropriate to a bourgeois revolutionary task in Germany in 1848 and then in Russia in 1905 and 1917? In other words, in its origins and in its success historically. Because, of course, the great success of Marxism is the Russian Revolution. And do we chalk that up to backwardness? Why not proletarian socialist revolution, and also why not Marxism in the West? What's conveniently ignored, of course, is that Marxism has a great role to play in France and also elsewhere, but especially in France after this period.
I was just going to add to that.
Mm-hmm.
I think this has echoes essentially a century later,
mm-hmm.
the way in which Marxism becomes involved after the Second World War and anti-colonial movements throughout what is now known as the Global South, and then the Third World War.
It's only exacerbated by the Chinese Revolution. Right, it's only exacerbated by the Chinese Revolution, the Vietnamese Revolution, the Cuban Revolution. This only exacerbates the problem because, of course, China is even more backwards than Russia had been in 1905 and 1917. And, of course, Russia in 1905 and 1917 is, in certain respects, even more backward than Germany was in 1948. Right, so what we have is a kind of trajectory that seems to further emphasize the backward character of Marxism as an ideology. So what's the argument against it? In other words, how would one render Marxism as a perspective plausible? Well, it all hinges on how Marxism comes out of the experience of 1848. In other words, what are the lessons learned? What is Marx's actual perspective on this? Trotsky already indicated that the problem with 1848 is that it's simultaneously, apparently, too soon and too late, that its failure can be attributed to being too soon and too late. Of course, 1789 and 1830 were successful, in a way that 1848 is not. So this question of too early and too late is very specific. It's with respect to capitalism, it's with respect to the working class, that the industrial working class is a new factor in history. It doesn't exist in 1789, and it plays a rather limited role in the July Revolution of 1830. In some ways, it also plays around the moment of the July Revolution, even a belated role, namely the uprising of Lyon, the textile workers in Lyon in 1831, after the July Revolution, under the July Monarchy. Which is, by the way, when Rosa Luxemburg, for one, dates the beginning of the class struggle of the workers against the capitalists. She dates it from the rising of the Lyon textile workers in 1831. So that's when the class struggle begins. So the explicit Marxist, where did she say that? In Reform or Revolution, I think. Yeah, it's in one of the things that we read.
Right.
Yeah, it's one of the things that we read. So Marxists have always been very clear that the working class is not like the workers throughout all of history. It's the industrial working class. It's the working class that's produced by the Industrial Revolution. We can also variously date it to the 1830s with respect to Chartism in the UK. So while there's not a revolution in Britain in 1848, however, there is an uprising in Ireland, for what that's worth. Again, backwardness. But there is Chartism before 1848. However, Chartism had already been politically defeated by 1848. One of the last acts that the Chartist movement does is translate Marx and Engels' Communist Manifesto. It serves as a kind of epitaph. They translate Marx and Engels' Communist Manifesto and then check out.
Just
and that's 1848.
Thinking of England as the demiurge of the bourgeois cosmos, why then does the class struggle between the work of capitalists emerge in France in 1831. I mean,
well, it doesn't emerge in France. It's not a spatial estimation, it's a historical estimation. In other words, when Luxembourg dates it, she dates it to 1831 because there's this event you can point to. However, she's aware that contemporaneously there's Chartism in England.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay.
But it doesn't have the spectacular character that that the Lyon uprising has. So again, you know, it's not an either or, and it certainly isn't a spatial signification. It's a historical periodization. And again, the character of the class struggle is different in the 1830s than in the 1840s. The 1830s is still a boom period. In other words, in some respects, the rising of the Lyon textile workers could be seen as conservative reactionary, meaning it's against the industrialization of in a boom time. It's not against unemployment in the 1840s, which is what you get in the 1848 revolution. The rising of the working class in the 1840s and 1848 in particular is about unemployment. It's not about work being changed by industrialization. Right? It's not about the de-skilling. It's about the unemployment, which is different.
In the 40s, it's about unemployment. In
yes.
The 30s, it's about de-skilling.
Yeah. It's about the jobs are still available, but the position of the working class seems to be subordinated to the machine. Right? Their position seems undermined. but without it being a matter of, you know.
What about the poor laws of workhouses?
In the UK?
Mm-hmm.
That's earlier.
It's like 32.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think the poor law is 32 or 34, somewhere in that period.
Okay.
And people are already being driven into these workhouses.
Uh-huh.
Driven off the land.
Well, driven off the land is different.
It's different.
Driven off the land is different. That's why I thought that you were talking about something earlier. Because there's like the vagabond laws. In other words, there's the question of where do the peasants go when they are kicked off the land and how they're forced into the city to become wage laborers. That's different from if you're unemployed, you're going to be thrown into a workhouse. There's a slight difference. Slight difference. Because being a peasant is not being employed. It's as simple as that. Like, there's no question of unemployment in the peasantry. These are subsistence agriculturalists. So them being kicked off the land is about them no longer being able to subsist agriculturally. It's not about them losing their job. It's a huge difference. So again, if we understand the peasants being forced into the cities, that's different from unemployed workers in the cities being forced into workhouses. At least from Marxist perspective, we prioritize the industrial working class as a phenomenon, and we have to distinguish between those. And Chartism is a working class movement, it's not a peasant movement. It's an urban working class movement. And it's a movement for expanding the franchise, it's a movement for suffering.
And this would be why Luddism also is not continuous with this history.
That's right.
Because it's kind of resisting de-skilling.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
That's right. So, yeah, the Luddites, that's more a function of proletarianization. Whereas here we're talking about the crisis of the proletariat. We're not talking about becoming industrial workers. We're talking about the crisis of being an industrial worker. That would have to be distinguished.
Mm-hmm.
And so really the hypothesis of Marxism is that what makes 1848 new and different is the existence of the proletariat. In other words, it's the emergence of proletarian socialism. So there's socialism, but the question is it proletarian socialism? It's not proletarian socialism until the 1830s in the UK and really in the 1840s in the continent. Prior to that, you have all sorts of socialism. You have utopian socialism, Christian socialism. You have a kind of rural versus urban socialism. If we trace socialism back to Bethune's conspiracy of equals in the French Revolution, it undergoes several phases of substantial transformation between that time and what has resulted, though, by 1848, why Marx and Engels can write the Communist Manifesto as they do, is that something new in the history of socialism has emerged, namely proletarian socialism. Proletarian socialism is only one variety of socialism. Proudhon is against it. So is Ferdinand LaSalle. Right, they're for socialism. Not really for proletarian socialism, though. Because the idea is that, well, industrial workers are just degraded by industrial labor. Right? They're dehumanized by industrial labor. You can't build a movement out of that. So LaSalle has the idea that you have to build a movement out of their citizenship rather than as industrial workers. So he says you can't organize objects as objects. You have to organize subjects as subjects. So if you try to organize the proletarianized working class as such, you're just organizing people to put forward their interests as objects. You have to organize them as citizens. That's the only way that you can organize them as subjects. Otherwise, it's just objects and a mechanism. And so he had a great deal of disparagement for the idea of proletarian socialism. So did Proudhon. Proudhon still has a kind of artisanal notion of the working. Proudhon, who stands aloof in the Revolution of 1848, he's sort of shocked by it. He's shocked both by the February Revolution, he's cool to the February Revolution, he rejects it precisely as a bourgeois democratic revolution. And he's also shocked and cold to the workers' uprising in June of 1848. What he ends up doing in the Second Republic, Proudhon, this is when he addresses Louis Bonaparte and he says, can you be the champion of the working class against the capitalists? And that's a dynamic that is recapitulated later by LaSalle approaching Bismarck to be a champion of the workers against the capitalists, precisely against the liberal bourgeoisie. Right? So Proudhon makes an appeal to Louis Bonaparte against the liberal bourgeoisie in precisely the same way that Bertrand LaSalle makes a appeal to Bismarck against the liberals. Marx has a different road. Marx is different from Proudhon and LaSalle precisely on this point, the idea of proletarian socialism per se. For Marx, what the results of the failures of the revolution in 1848, it shows the necessity of proletarian socialism. In other words, that all other forms of politics are bankrupt. Only proletarian socialism might lead forward. Trotsky acknowledges that in 1906. He says, up till now, this is just an abstract possibility. It's never happened yet. So it's never happened yet that proletarian socialism can lead beyond the impasse of 1848. But we think it might. That's true still in 1917. In other words, in 1917, it's not, by virtue of the Soviets taking power, it's not proven that proletarian socialism is the way forward. Not by any means, because for that you need a world revolution, which is, of course, Trotsky's point in Results and Prospects. So proletarian socialism might lead past the impasse of 1848, but it hasn't been proven, even up till today, that it does. Instead, from a strictly Marxist perspective, meaning from Marx's own perspective, what we have is Bonapartism. Everything since 1848 has been Bonapartism. Meaning the Russian Revolution produced Bonapartism. The German Revolution produced Bonapartism. Every third world revolution has produced Bonapartism. It's all been Bonapartism. Only proletarian socialism might, but we've never seen it yet.
I already asked this question to Spencer once, but actually I'd like to hear your thoughts on this as well. And that is that we implied to stress Bonapartism as this constitutive moment of post-1851 at least.
It's the election.
Okay, but Marx himself doesn't use that term so much anymore. So, like, where do you see kind of the prominence of that conceptualization for him in the following years?
You mean after 1852?
Yeah.
It's the dictatorship of the proletariat. And he does return to the question of Bonapartism in his writing on the Paris Commune. He says the Paris Commune is the inverse of the empire. Meets the same need that the empire met.
I think Spencer formulated in a way to me to say that basically once they start theorizing about imperialism, it's really the same thing, right? Or
that term isn't really used, but it's, I guess it's used a bit by Marx in some of his journalism. That term is really a later term, though. But yes, imperialism is Bonapartism, meaning it's not colonialism. Imperialism is the imperial state. It's the empire. Which Disraeli, the prime minister, Tory prime minister in the UK, he also declares the British Empire as an empire, meaning he crowns Queen Victoria as empress. And he does that specifically as a political move against the liberals. And he gets a lot of working class support for it. But not because the working class cares about India, but because they do warm to the idea of an imperial state against the liberals, precisely. Against the liberal bourgeoisie. So the idea would be that Louis Bonaparte, Otto von Bismarck, Lord Palmerston, Benjamin Disraeli, these are all figures of this turn in the 19th century towards Bonapartism. Again, in the usual Marxist language, it's no accident that it happens everywhere at the same time. Now, in the history of Marxism, we also get the idea that the foundation of the imperial state in the United States is the Civil War. It's Abraham Lincoln in the Civil War. And Ulysses S. Grant, in his memoirs, makes mention of this, in fact, very liberally. He says, he invokes Abraham Lincoln's Gettysburg Address, that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. But what that refers to, because you get that also in Lincoln's pre-election speeches, it refers to the idea that after 1848, that the U.S. might be the last democratic republic on earth.
Hmm.
Yeah. So it's the last democratic republic on earth, but it's threatened by the slaveocracy. And so the Civil War is self-consciously understood by Lincoln and the radical Republicans.
And Palmerston's and Bonaparte's support for the South.
Yeah, exactly. That in fighting against slavery, in fighting against the Democratic Party, in fighting against the slaveocracy, in fighting to keep the Union, it's to preserve democratic republicanism. Which, of course, has its origins in the American and French revolutions. 1776 and 1789. So basically, the idea is we're the last man standing on democratic republicanism, and we have to prosecute the Civil War to preserve it. And Grant, in his memoirs, specifically invokes Louis Bonaparte. In other words, he says, look, Napoleon Bonaparte, I've never been a fan. He says, I've never been a fan of Napoleon Bonaparte, but he might have been necessary, and he did have some qualities, and specifically as a revolutionary figure. So Louis Bonaparte lacks any such redeeming quality. Right? Louis Bonaparte is just an example of what happens if you give up the Democratic Republic. And so again, this is towards the end of his life, it's much later, but he's looking back over his own career and looking back. He got his start in the 1848 Mexican-American War, at which he opposed. And in retrospect, he says it's the worst mistake the United States had made up to that point, was the Mexican-American War, precisely because it fed Bonapartism. He says the Mexican-American War fed precisely the same phenomenon that one saw in Europe in the aftermath of the failed revolutions of 1848. He makes explicit reference to that. He's read his Marx, by the way. Of course, the there are Marxists in the Republican.
When we talk about Bonapartism, we're talking about Louis Bonaparte?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, not Napoleon Bonaparte.
Okay.
It's not Napoleonism, it's Bonapartism, which is different.
Okay.
So, in this conception, where are you dating American Bonapartism? Because I think the discussion started with the Civil War being the emergence of...
The imperial presidency. The imperial presidency. But this is kind of a botched idea. Meaning, Reconstruction showed the necessity of the dictatorship of the proletariat. In the absence of Reconstruction, what you get is Bonapartism. And as we know from reading Richard S. Frazier, what is Bonapartism in the United States? The Democratic Party. The Democratic Party. Not only in the South, not only is Jim Crow Bonapartism, but also the Democratic Party is an urban ethnic constituency party in the North of the industrial world. That's what makes it a Bonapartist party. The Republicans are liberals. The Democrats are Bonapartists.
And big capitalists are
Republicans. The Republicans, well, they're liberals, right? So again, right, that means that they're hanging on to the bourgeois ideal. Now, of course, after Grant's time, in the Gilded Age, after failure of Reconstruction, you do get essentially the crisis of liberalism in the United States. And that's expressed by progressivism. And progressivism is a movement that spans the two parties. It spans the Democrats and the Republicans, Teddy Roosevelt, etc. But, when Warren Harding is elected in 1920 instead of the Democrats, after Woodrow Wilson, he's not more conservative than the Democrats by any means. And that's illustrated by the fact that he immediately pardons Eugene Debs and invites him to the White House.
Invited Debs to the White House.
Yeah. And he also had a shadow cabinet, a black cabinet. He had a black American cabinet because, of course, the Republicans rely upon the black middle-class constituency in the South, as well as other parts of the country. So he also appoints the first cabinet-level black people after Reconstruction, pardon. So there's no way that the Democrats are more liberal than the Republicans, even as late as 1920. So the big change in the Democratic Party is, of course, FDR. And Trotsky called FDR a Bonapartist. That's just a little bit of a digression down American history. Of course, 1848 doesn't quite register in American history, other than very obliquely. And that's because the United States is really industrialized later. It's
in the 60s.
After the Civil War, really. But what I was going to say is that it's part of global capitalism, but the largest capital asset in the United States before the Civil War, most capital in the United States, is in the form of slave property, the property of slaves. So that's why people refer to the emancipation of the slaves as the greatest expropriation of property in world history, because it is. The slaves are very expensive. So in terms of, like, people would take out loans based on how many slaves they owned. Like, the slaves were their collateral. So you take out a loan to expand your farm based on the number of slaves you owned. They were capital assets. They were part of the valuation of the dollar on the world market, the value of the slaves. So that just goes to show, of course, there were industrial workers in the United States before the Civil War, of course, but they played a very subordinate role in the economy and in politics.
In terms of 1848 showing itself in the United States, I mean, it does kind of, with a pause in that a lot of the revolutionaries go to exile. I mean, Marx was contemplating going to exile.
Come to the United States, yeah, they do come to the United States, absolutely. And of course, the crisis of the Whig Party.
And then become a party.
Yeah, the crisis of the Whig Party, the destruction of the Whig Party, and the rise of the Republican Party, which the Republican Party was around for less than 10 years before they elected Abraham Lincoln. So they go 0 to 16 in less than 10 years. They go from the destruction of one of the major parties to electing the president in a very short amount of time. The crisis of the Whig Party is also part of mid-19th century crisis, certainly. The Whig Party, of course, being the liberals. Right, that's what the Whigs were. So it was a crisis of the liberal party in the United States.
I just wanted to add as a side note to what Gregor just said, I just discovered a wonderful book titled Lincoln's Marxists, and it's by a Southern sympathizer who carefully reconstructs the careers of all these figures who then came over and became Republicans in the U.S.
Oh, to show how the Republican Party was infiltrated by Marxists.
Exactly. Yeah, but it's pretty careful. I mean,
the Red 48ers. They're called the Red 48ers, and there are many. And of course, in the Civil War itself, sorry for this lengthy digression on the United States, but American history is important. In the Civil War itself, most of the career military people went to the South. So, you know, Robert E. Lee, of course. So, but others. And so they have to build up the officer corps. And they do so with many of these German radicals. The officer corps is populated by the Red 48ers.
Kosuth, I think, was from Hungary.
Yeah, and also from Austria-Hungary. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yes. And of course, in order to get those positions, those appointments, the officer commissions, they have to be politically Republicans and Democrats, of course. So there's a great deal of overlap between political organization and military organization in the Civil War. Of course. Maybe that doesn't need to be said, but nonetheless. You have politicized militaries at the bottom line. And so that's a ramification of 1848 for sure. So finally, you know, what I wanted to emphasize with respect to the Marxist point of departure is that the proletariat is not only a negative category with respect to political economy. In other words, it's not only the working class after it's become expropriated by capital. It's not only the value of labor as undermined and expropriated by capital, the new industrial working class as exemplar. It's not only negative in terms of political economy, but it's also negative in terms of politics. So what I was mentioning earlier, it's in the face of the bankruptcy, the utter bankruptcy of all other forms of politics, that the dictatorship of the proletariat reveals itself as necessary to Marx. And he is unique among all socialists in this respect. He writes to his editor of the 18th Premier, Joseph Weidemeyer, he writes to him, after he's submitted it for publication, he says, you know, the only real contribution I made originally is my discovery of the necessity of the dictatorship of the proletariat. That's my one contribution. That's what Marx said. And it's precisely that that's been forgotten. Right? So precisely what you have is the regression to what Marx considered petty bourgeois democracy, which had been demonstrated to be utterly bankrupt in 1848, in a way that it was not in 1789. After all, that was the Jacobins. They were the petty bourgeois Democrats. It's not cool. Right. So why 1848 and Marxism? Because the degree to which Marx ever changed his mind about anything in his life, it was in the aftermath of the failure of the revolutions in 1848. Meaning there's a direct line between his points of departure in the early 1840s, his critique of political economy in The Poverty of Philosophy in 1847. There's a direct line between that and Capital, and Das Kapital. The only change that one observes in Marx's perspective is his change from the program of the manifesto. And the only change in the program of the manifesto is that it's got to be the dictatorship of the proletariat. Meaning in the manifesto, he says, we're part of the Democratic Party, the small d Democratic Party. We don't distinguish ourselves from other parties. We participate in the Democratic Party, small d Democrats, meaning the Democratic Revolutionaries. After 1848, that's no longer his perspective. His perspective is no longer a democratic revolution, but proletarian socialist dictatorship. So that's why Marxism begins in 1848. Marxism as a politics begins in the aftermath of 1848. Marx as a social philosopher, he predates that. But Marx as a unique politician comes out of 1848. And again, that uniqueness is the dictatorship of the proletariat.
But Kautsky's reference originally was in his critique of Luxembourg, that she's going back to the Marx of 1848.
Yep. 1848 to 1850. All right, so up to the address to the Communist League. What we read in the reading group syllabus is precisely those writings by Marx that Luxembourg, Lenin, and Trotsky make reference to. So the writings about 1848 and the aftermath of 1848. So they're always quoting that. The Junius pamphlet, The Crisis of German Social Democracy, quotes directly from Marx's class struggles in France, 1848 to 1850, to attack the petty bourgeois Democrats who come out of every calamity, spick and span, clean.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh, just a series of unfortunate events.
We're going to try a little harder next time.
Yeah, we just try harder next time, right? There's nothing wrong with our program. Right? We're pure, it's just that the world is this bad place where shit happens. Right? And so that's the limited horizon of petty bourgeois democracy, precisely in contrast to what is being defined negatively, because we've never seen it in practice, the dictatorship of the proletariat. Mm-hmm.
I guess I want to pose a kind of big question. I'm not sure if I can really do it coherently, but I think you'll get thrust with this. Like, mainly the kind of the apparent plausibility of, I forget if it was Cutrone or Cassell, but this idea that.
So a lot of similarities between the
two. And this idea that a specifically proletarian socialism is expressing merely the object and not the subject. And there's a way in which I listened to the interview, which was very good, that you had with the French architect.
Oh, was it there?
And you kind of, you talked about this in a way, like the way it comes to appear because of the conservative forces in the labor movement by the middle of the 20th century. A lot of different strands on the left. I'm thinking of strands I'm familiar with in the new communist movement, but also communization theory.
Mm-hmm.
Really either, they either just totally go in for a kind of like bourgeois democracy, a kind of petit bourgeois democratic politics in the form of embracing nationalism or other particularisms, or at best, they simply register this utter exhaustion of any hope for like a proletarian socialist politics.
So here's the thing, vulgar Marxism, right? So what's vulgar Marxism? In a word, it's undialectical Marxism. So one of the ways in which vulgar Marxism is undialectical is its conflation of the categories of working class and proletarian. They're not the same. It's not the same. Again, not because it's two different sociological groups, no. In that respect, it's the same. But rather, whether you're addressing it sociologically or whether you're addressing it historically. And so the working class, until it takes up the task of the dictatorship of the proletariat, is just the working class. And so, of course, the working class, you know, the value critic people and communization theorist people, there are some differences, but there is some overlap. They just discover after the 60s, oh, the working class are actually the most bourgeois class in society. Of course, right? But in that respect, they're neglecting the difference between the working class and the proletariat. Proletariat, if we were to talk about it sociologically, it would be everyone who has to work for wage labor, whether they're working for it or not. Meaning, it's not just the employed workers, it's the unemployed. Right? So if you look at it sociologically, you can define it that way, but I think it's misleading even to do that. Right? That really has to be seen as an emergent property of capitalism, as a historical category, rather than as a sociological category. Right? So the question is whether the working class can act in its proletarian class interests. Right? Because proletarian class interests are not the interests of the workers as wage laborers. The interest of the working class as proletarians is as socialists, not as wage laborers. Right? So it's only when the working class becomes socialist, when it takes up the task of proletarian socialism, that it becomes possible to have the dictatorship of the proletariat, which is not just the interests of the working class as such. Right? It's the task of ruling society, because it's the task of abolishing itself as a working class, abolishing wage labor.
Now, is this connected to the formulation of the dictatorship of the proletariat as Bonapartism? Or?
Yes, it's related, because if the working class were to take power and just act in their interests as wage laborers, then you'd just have proletarian Bonapartism. You wouldn't have proletarian socialism. You'd have like working class Bonapartism. You wouldn't have proletarian Bonapartism. You'd have working class Bonapartism, which we've seen. Peronism. You know, we've seen this in the world.
I have a question about the difference between petty bourgeois democracy, like sort of like a worker, I guess like the demands expropriate the expropriators.
Uh-huh.
Is this, like when you say the dictatorship of the proletariat is negative, is it being reduced to like a petty bourgeois demand? When it's considered as like,
yeah,
expropriate the expropriator.
Absolutely, because after all, capitalism expropriates. It
right.
does, and then the capitalists are blamed for that. Meaning, people go out of business, workers are thrown out of work, they become unemployed, and it's understood that it's like the capitalists who are doing it. And so, you know, again, the degree to which what makes petty bourgeois democracy petty bourgeois is that it thinks that the problem is that there are rich people who are eluding democratic control, right? So that's why it's petty bourgeois democracy. So it's a kind of raisonnement, to use Nietzsche's expression. I think Adolf put it in his interview with us. He said, oh no, not in the interview, in the panel discussion, Adolf Reed said, you know, in the Alpha countries, the counter-revolution or the reactionaries tried to say, we've turned society over to the broke losers, right? Turning society over to the broke losers, that's petty bourgeois democracy. Right. Being a broke loser in capitalism doesn't lead to socialism. It leads to fascism or some soft version of that nationalism, whatever. You know, it leads to religious fundamentalism, like in the Iranian Revolution. Right? It's the broke losers take over. That's not socialism. Although it hasn't prevented the left in every instance from saying, this is socialism, including in the Iranian Revolution.
And Spencer will make this argument that, I mean, in terms of 20th century Stalinism and anti-colonial revolt, that, again, imperialism is understood as colonialism.
Yeah,
as,
outside.
Whereas exactly where it's really the concept for Marxism refers to the way the working class is constituted in Great Britain, in the United States, in Germany, in France, right? That kind of like has a stake in the, that it gets a kind of a cut of the profits in these countries, right? So that, but at the same time, this means that we talk, I mean,
it also happens in Tsarist Russia. So Tsarist Russia, so I quoted Results and Prospects. So one of the things that Trotsky does there is to say, Tsarist Russia is a capitalist state. It's just the form of Bonapartism in Russia. In other words, it's not some kind of medieval phenomenon. It's a modern state, and it is a Bonapartist state. For the same reason you have a Bonapartist state in any country. So what you have is wealthy Bonapartism and impoverished Bonapartism. So wealthy Bonapartism, you get the welfare state. Impoverished Bonapartism, you have pogroms. So it's not just that they get a cut of the spoils of empire. No. What did the Russian workers get? They got to be Russian workers against the non-Russians, against the Jews, right? So, you know, the working class was originally organized in the Tsarist Empire by the Tsar through the Orthodox Church, through the Russian Orthodox Church. That's why it's Father Capon who's leading the demonstration in 1905. That's why it's impossible to distinguish between the police spies and the real leaders of the working class, because the police spies are the real leaders of the working class. Right, so in other words, people don't know whether Father Capon is leading the workers to address the Tsar, whether that's a Tsarist plot to set up the workers to be massacred, or whether he's a kind of naive guy who thinks that he can like lead the workers to appeal to the Tsar and then he can tamp down their discontents. So he doesn't expect the troops to open fire and he feels betrayed. Right? But the socialists think, oh, he's just the police infiltrator who set up the workers to be shot. Well, regardless of his intention, of course, that's what he was. Right? Because it became necessary for the Tsarist state to try to organize the working class. That's Bonapartism. It's political authority under capitalism. So again, these are dialectical categories, meaning that the same need expressed in Bonapartism would have to be met by the dictatorship of the proletariat. That's why people who condemn the Russian Revolution, they just say, oh, Lenin's the new Tsar. Yes, of course he is. What else is he going to be? That's it.
I guess the perception is he could have been a Democrat.
Well, he was a Democrat, of course. I mean, you know, I guess you could say that it's only Stalin who embraces the role, right? But even Stalin doesn't really embrace the role. Like, none of the Stalinist leaders actually embrace the role of, you know, being the new Tsar. It's, you have to wait until Putin comes along to get avowed neo-Tsarism, right? But again, the question is any national government in the former Russian Empire compelled to replicate czarism? Yes, it is, but why? Not because some people believe in hierarchy and some people don't. It's because it's an objective world historical need, Bonapartism. It's there. The only question is what we do with it. There's no escaping. The only escape is petty bourgeois democracy, which leads to Bonapartism anyway, ultimately, except in a more rounded out and politically disorganized way.
So I want to return to this distinction of working class and proletarian. I'm curious, like, how Marx imagined in 1848, and then potentially how we might yet imagine kind of navigating this politically in terms of involvement with the actual existing organizations of the working class. Like, what gave them at that time a proletarian character? And is the proletarian character decided at the level of subjective ideology? Is that what essentially makes the difference?
For Marx, it's political necessity. So he has, in the passage that we'll read in the reading group for next week, not for the 1844 manuscripts and for the manifesto or the address to the Communist League of the following week, namely The Coming of People is what it's called in the Marx-Engels reader. It's a passage from The Poverty of Philosophy, the Marx critique of Proudhon. He says two things. He says, basically, the capitalist class doesn't exist until it's confronted by the working class. And then once the working class confronts the capitalist class, once the capitalists have to say, oh shit, we better get our act together facing the workers. Once that happens, then the workers are confronting something new, namely a unified capitalist class. And when the working class meets the political necessity of confronting a unified capitalist class, that's when the working class starts down the road of the necessity of the dictatorship of the proletariat. But up to that point, no. And in order for that to happen, you have to have a working class party. You can't just have unions. In other words, you can have unions that cause the capitalist class to get their act together, but then for the workers to take the next step, they have to make a party. And once they make a party, then they're saying, we want to take over. So it's, you see, there are several steps. It's a political logic that Marx envisions. And so that's why the worst thing a Leninist could ever call someone is a liquidationist. Because it means you're liquidating the party, which means that you're basically, you know, abandoning the entire question of socialism and of the proletarian character of the working class. You're giving up the political field to what will be petty bourgeois democracy. Or worse, it will just be, you know, state technocracy or whatever. But you're giving up the field of democratic revolution to the petty bourgeois democrats. All right, so Brian is asking, the way 1848 is typically presented by historians is as the flowering of European nationalism, the spring of nations. Unlike France, in the Habsburg Empire, Italy, Germany, the demand to form a nation plays a central role. Marx and Mazzini recognize the danger of nationalism after 1848. Should we understand nationalism as an ideological expression of Bonapartism? Surely, surely, most definitely. What I'd say is that Marx and Engels themselves have some equivocation on this question. In other words, they, like other radicals of the 19th century, distinguish between progressive and reactionary nations. Quite unfortunately, because it sets the stage for a lot of bad Stalinism in the 20th century. So when third world nationalists are allied with the Soviet Union, it's because they are progressive nations, and when they're against the Soviet Union, it's because they're reactionary nations. So it's just some nonsense. But anyway, you know, so there are no progressive and reactionary nations. So why nationalism? Because nationalism, I would say, is not only a Central and Eastern European phenomenon in 1848. It's also foundational in the avowed ideology of Louis Bonaparte in the election of December 1848, the rise of Louis Bonapartism. Right. So in that respect, we could say that everywhere it has to take the form of nationalism. Because after all, crowning Queen Victoria Empress in the UK is about nationalism. It's not about, again, it's not about India. It's about British nationalism and really English nationalism. So why? That's the question. Why? This is a tricky one because in the literature, including in Trotsky's 1906 Results and Prospects, there is this idea of a national road to revolution. Not a national road to socialism, but a national road to revolution. In other words, revolution is understood as a national phenomenon, at least initially. Right, and you get some of the language in Marx and Engels themselves is that the working class has to settle its score with its own national capitalists, with its own national bourgeoisie. The idea is that it necessarily leads beyond that. In other words, and again, in the literature there's some ambiguity with respect to this, but the idea is that it necessarily leads beyond that. So the question is, maybe put the other way, how Marxists understood the necessity of the workers leading the revolution in any given nation. And that's where the language from Trotsky's Results and Prospects that I read at the outset comes into play. Myself, my own take on this is that the nation state is an emergent phenomenon of the 19th century, whereas now we've been living with it for quite some time. And in many respects, the nation state as an emergent phenomenon doesn't come into its own until after World War I. In other words, really before World War I, you don't have nation states, you have empires. And it's after World War I that you get the Wilsonian settlement and you get nation states. In other words, you get decolonization, you get the breakup of empires. And so rather than telescoping that as some kind of inevitability, in other words, is it only World War I and its aftermath that finally settles the tasks of 1848? That would be a nationalist view. The nationalist view would be 1848 is the spring of the nations, is the emergence of nationalism, which only really gets fully expressed as an accomplishment after World War I. In some respects, not even then, really after World War II. Harry Anderson, for instance, thinks this. Right. This is how they're able to square the circle of petty bourgeois democracy and socialism. That they basically say, well, look, you don't really have nations in Europe until after World War II. However, from a Marxist perspective, it's no longer the national struggle that it might have been in 1848. Meaning you could say that the national struggle of 1848 is finally realized after World War II, but only in the most conservative reactionary worst way possible. And of course, not without the rather unfortunate interregnum of fascism. Meaning, you know, from a certain perspective, certainly from the Frankfurt School perspective, the nation state after World War II is not the product of deferred revolution in 1848, but is the product of fascism. You know, meaning Italian unification. In some respects, it's only Mussolini who completes that. You know, forget Garibaldi and Mazzini, it's Mussolini who does that.
And also in the East, the Japanese Empire's conquest of a lot of East Asian countries basically has the effect of
consolidating them as nations.
Yes, and then kind of like bringing them free from the colonial empires. So there's a whole set of like petit bourgeois, like nationalist revolutionaries who like hate the Japanese, but are kind of, they take courage from the Japanese conquest in the sense that it. Sort of
that's what James Hartfield was telling me on Facebook, but he's wrong about that.
Okay.
Yeah, he's wrong about that. I mean, he, only because it short circuits some things. Meaning that, you know, Ho Chi Minh. Right. The question is, what would it mean to democratize the empire? You know, what is the struggle against colonialism really about? Is it about nationalism? Right? It becomes about nationalism. And it becomes about nationalism in large measure. So Ho Chi Minh's emergence on the political scene is he's at Versailles in 1919. And he's like, how can I use this Wilson, this Woodrow Wilson program to advance my agenda? Right? Without the United States endorsing the nation state, the 20th century would have had a different history. Right, but we should not naturalize the breakup of empire. Breakup of empire was not inevitable, and it's not progressive. Because it's just created more problems. If you look at the Middle East, in the breakup of the Ottoman Empire, we're still living with the effects of that. No. Arab nationalism? No. Never worked, and it's just been a horror for all the non-Arab minorities.
So then if fascism, if you would consider it a product of deferred revolution in 1848, then what do you consider it a product of?
Capitalism. Meaning national statism is a way of coping with capitalism.
Mm-hmm.
It's a way of doing a couple of different things. It's a way of disciplining the labor market. And it's a way of organizing capital that handles two things in one stroke, the wage laborers and the capitalists. Both of which, in terms of global capitalism, might be seen rather naturally. In other words, if you don't deal with both of them at once, they're both traitors to the nation. The working class and the capitalists are both traitors to the nation from the standpoint of petty bourgeois democracy. Right, so you need a settlement that can include the workers and the capitalists with the petty bourgeois, and we shouldn't naturalize that because it's not stable. It's not been without great conflict and war, in fact. And it's not because we still live in the world of the ancients that Benjamin Constant told us about. Like, again, to naturalize it would be to say, well, it's always been nations, it always will be nations, etc. No. It's different. It's about capitalism. It's a phenomenon, it's a symptom of capitalism. Because Lenin's solution to World War I would not have been nationalism, would not have been a series of nation states. It would not have been throwing the workers back onto a national foundation for their struggle. You know, wouldn't have been, well, no, you have to like attack your national capitalist class. This came out in the debates between Lenin and M.N. Roy over India in the early Third International, where Lenin's like, well, it would seem to be the case that you have to, you know, fight against the British before you can deal with your own national capitalists. And M.N. Roy was like, well, you know, that raises the question of whether there are any national capitalists, and maybe we need national capitalists before we can have a working class movement. And Lenin is pretty much like, well, I just don't know. You tell me, you know, what the situation is there. But the idea that somehow, you know, the working class has to take a national struggle, that's Stalinism. You know, Stalinism is the idea that the working class has to, in a sense, produce its own nation state in order to be able to then, set at some later time down the road, pursue socialism. So it would have to, in a sense, constitute its own national capitalist class, which is totally reactionary. Something backward. Because there aren't really national bourgeoisies, there aren't really national capitalists any more than there are really national working classes. There are national states, but that's at a different level of society. Meaning the state, you know, the state, contrary to the nationalist, the state is not a monolith. Sociological entity. It certainly isn't an economic entity. Spring of the Nations, yeah, it's again bourgeois historiography. I'd say the bourgeois historiography, of course, doesn't believe that there is such a thing as proletarian socialism. So then what does 1848 look like? It looks like revolutions in countries that aren't properly constituted as nations. Right. The most properly constituted nation, the UK, doesn't have a revolution, and that's why it doesn't have a revolution. Or, if it does have a revolution, it's an uprising in Ireland. And why is that? Because Ireland needs to be a nation state. Right. France, it's understood as the, again, that would be the kind of case that eludes the historiography. It would be, well, is France a nation state? Maybe the Restoration monarchy put the constitution of the French nation back on the political agenda. And maybe that's why we have the Revolution in 1848. But it kind of stretches the point. That's why France becomes the exemplary case, because when you look at Central and Eastern Europe, you can more easily avoid the question of proletarian socialism. That's why it's the June uprising of 1848 that is the crossroads of history for Marxism. It's actually not when the Western German capitalists refuse to distribute arms to their workers to defend themselves against the Prussians. Right. Now, the crossroads of history is June 1848. Why? Because it's clear, it's not a muddled case of national liberation. It's just workers being put down by liberals to limit the revolution. So, speaking as a Marxist, I'm making my 2015 address to the Central Committee of the Platypus League. Was this what I was commissioned to present on, Joseph? Speaking, intoning the ghost of Marx, presenting the manifesto, is this what you wanted? To which they probably said, not really.
It's precisely what.
All right.
Well, the difficulty we come up against is in the reading group not being able to get to the text because we're covering the sort of broad swath of history. And this is sort of contextualize that in a way that allows to sort of get into the individual text.
Usually in the session, right, we have to do some kind of thumbnail sketch.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And so instead of the thumbnail sketch that makes the reading group session impossible, practically, we have the, I don't know what, the thumbnail sketch instead of the thumbnail sketch. This is still pretty sketchy. It's just a little bit of a bigger sketch.
Can I ask something about the this idea of the dictatorship of the proletariat and that it's not about the workers working in their own interests, but rather like as socialists? That's the relationship of like the pursuit of their private interests as workers and running up against the inability to do so, that then it, like the necessity of like socialism and thus like the political subject of like proletariat, is that?
Well, okay, this is the way Marx always proceeds with respect to this is symptomatically, meaning that he's got different cases in the socialist movement that he plays off each other antinomically and therefore dialectically. So it's not that Proudhon and LaSalle are wrong in saying that the workers can't act as economic actors but must act as political actors. They're not wrong about that. However, what they are wrong in is in the undialectical counterposition. You're either acting economically or you're acting politically. That's where they're wrong. That's where they're one-sided. Just as there are other socialists who say, don't bother with the political struggle, just look at the economic struggle. And that's anarcho-syndicalism. That's Bakunin. Right? Who's not wrong either, right? Except in being one-sided. Right? So it's only in the dialectical interplay of these opposed perspectives, Bakunin versus LaSalle, that Marx emerges. And that's why Marx can sometimes appear like a Bakuninist or sometimes like a LaSallean, because people basically approach him undialectically. He's neither and he's both. And that's the way Marx develops his political perspective. He looks at the controversies of his time and he looks at how the antinomy points beyond itself. And again, it recapitulates itself, meaning it emerges in a certain way in 1848 and then emerges again in the controversies of the first. First International and emerges yet again in the Paris Commune.
What seems kind of paradoxical or tricky about it is that, like, you're saying it's historically specific to the emergence of the proletariat, but it's not identical
right.
at any point. So it's like the proletariat's political, they form a party, these are their interests as workers, but it's kind of like the public reason, private reason distinction. Like,
this is why Mike McNair, it's why Mike McNair says what's usually neglected but is actually crucial is Chartism. But then Chartism becomes this funny mixed case that it's political and economic. And so, you know, it becomes this other undialectical version. Because of course, for Marx, Chartism is the most advanced expression of the task of proletarian socialism. But it's hardly clear about itself either theoretically or practically. And it fails as well. It fails just as certainly as LaSalleanism and Bakuninism fail. And it also succeeds, meaning it survives. You know, like we say that, you know, the Labour Party in the UK is some kind of fulfillment of Chartism. Sure. Right? In the same way the SPD is the fulfillment of LaSalleanism. And the same way the far left is dominated by Bakuninism. Sure. So it is this, essentially, we're talking about a task. We're not talking about a thing. Right, so proletarian socialism is not a thing, it's a task.
So it's a task of proletarian politics, you know, when we sort of analogize it to Bonapartism. If the task of Bonapartism is to, you know, make people understand their interests as capital, is the, you know, the task of proletarian politics the task of seeing people's interests as proletarian interests? Like,
no, it would be capital. It would also be capital. In other words, what Bonapartism versus the dictatorship of the proletariat give us is the task of reappropriating capital. Right? So in other words, why is Bonapartism right wing? Because it's an attempt to appropriate capital, but it compromises itself, first of all, nationalistically, and second of all, partially, meaning even within the national context, the way it appropriates the general social intellect. So what is Louis Bonaparte? What does Mike McNair say Louis Bonaparte is? He's a modernizer, meaning what he does is modernize France. So he engages in massive rebuilding of Paris, right? He kind of brings France up to date for modern capitalism. And he does so in a way that makes up for the weakness of the capitalist class. So for Mike McNair, Bonapartism is just backwardness, but what in the UK would have been done by the capitalists, the state has to do in France. The kernel of truth in that is that, of course, what Bonaparte is doing is taking over the task of capital politically. But what you'll find is that that's also happening in the UK, and it's also going to happen in the United States. In other words, it's not, you know, French backwardness. It's very bizarre to say that France is particularly backward. You could say, well, Bismarck is a great modernizer of Germany, right? He unifies and modernizes Germany. Again, if you defer the question to backwardness, then it just becomes a displacement of the question of capital. Meaning, are we dealing with the backwardness of capital, or are we dealing with its overripeness? Are we dealing with its advanced, late character? So the task of the dictatorship of the proletariat is to reappropriate capital. Bonapartism meets that task, but in a very limited way.
Well, how would you distinguish, I mean, from the limited form? I mean, because you described how Bonapartism realizes capital in a certain way, and the dictatorship of the proletariat would realize capital in a different way. What's the distinction?
When we were talking about this on the pedagogues call, so in the 1844 manuscripts, Marx says that if we were to realize Proudhon's demand to abolish private property, that all that would do is turn the state into one giant capitalist over all of its members. That would be the dictatorship of the proletariat, meaning when the working class as an organized political force, at least in one party, but probably in several parties, becomes a capitalist over society, right? Basically appropriate society as capital, then what would the next step be? The next step would be to confront the contradiction between capital and wage labor, meaning if it doesn't immediately lead to the abolition of wage labor, then you just get a kind of backsliding into a reconstitution of capitalism. And so, you know, again, the question is the state, and which state is that? It's not a national state. Meaning, if you think about it, if you think about the working class at a global level organizing political parties to assert global governance in which it's managing capital, you're immediately going to find that wage labor goes away. In other words, you just have, like, you know, essentially a kind of basic income established for everybody in the world. You're not going to have wage labor anymore. It would naturally follow that once you have a preponderance of global capital being administered by workers in a unified state, a dictatorship of the proletariat, wage labor is going to be the first, in a sense, wrinkle that they come up against, which is, how are we allocating resources? Are we allocating resources on the basis of paying the workers' wages and having the wages feed back into the system? No, it would immediately lead beyond that.
But what, I guess it's pushing the point that's come up a few times with imagining the proletariat as the subject object of history versus capital. Because what is the interest of capital when we're discussing, you know, proletarian parties as realizing the task of capital? Wouldn't that be realizing the interest of the proletariat?
Sure, but that's because capital and proletariat are dialectical terms, meaning they don't really mean anything apart from the other. Meaning all that capital is the alienation of the proletariat. Right? It's not like a thing. It's not like, we're not talking about like tools or, you know,
it's the congealed labor of the past.
Right. And so, again, what we have now is like dead labor and living labor clashing as opposed to realizing each other, right? So when we, that's why colloquially the misrecognition of capital is that it's the means of production. It's the private property and the means of production. That's the sort of first order of misrecognition. But it's not that. It's obviously the whole organization of society, it's science and technology, it's the general social intellect, according to Marx, it's all of that. Well, how do you appropriate that, actually? You certainly can't appropriate it, by the way, just through workplace democracy. It has to be the state. But the question is, what is the state, then? Right? Because once the state, you know, transitions its symptomatic expression, meaning the state is that, but the state is also not that. Now, already. It's already that. The other phrase from Marx is that the dictatorship of the proletariat marks the transition from the governing of men to the administration of things.
About Proudhon, though.
Mm-hmm.
He seems like he's being just like kind of dismissive, negative.
Well, he's what he is essentially someone who's shipwrecked by history, meaning that at least according to Marx, meaning it's petty bourgeois socialism. It's not really able to deal with the condition of the proletariat as such, namely the Industrial Revolution. It has essentially an artisanal conception, right? That, you know, workers contribute wealth to society and ought to enjoy the wealth that they produce, as if the problem of capital, as if the value of that wealth in society is not a problem. Right? It's only a problem of distribution. It's only a problem of inequality. It's only a problem of corruption of the state. Right? He's stuck in a pre-1848 world, according to Marx. And in many respects, he's stuck before an 1840 world as well. And so, you know, that's
before the crisis of
structural unemployment, essentially, before that's manifest, right? Again, for Proudhon, it's a problem of distribution, which is can also be understood as a problem of political disenfranchisement, by the way, right? Which is the way LaSalle sees it, but that's why they're connected. So again, you can see it as a problem of distribution of economic power, or as a problem of the distribution of political power. But Proudhon at least has the virtue of not being a Democrat. he's an anarchist? You know, meaning he's asked, are you a Democrat? And he says, no, I'm an anarchist. Meaning I'm not for the rule of the people, I'm for the rule of no one. So what he wants is just worker cooperation, spontaneous worker cooperation. And what Marx says is, you know, essentially the accumulation of capital, the antagonism and the contradiction between value and wealth and capital makes that into a petty bourgeois fantasy. It's impossible.
So when you're saying that when Marx is critiquing Proudhon's formulation that like elimination of private property would just be constituting the state as capital to overall society, that's somehow the same as the dictatorship of the proletariat, that Marx is saying like yes, and we have to go beyond that?
Yes.
That's like the kind of critique he's making?
That's the kind of critique he's making, because of course what he's saying, when he says that if we realized Proudhon's program, you would just turn the state into one giant capitalist over its members, what he's saying is if you were to realize Proudhon's program, it would do the opposite of Proudhon thinks he's going to get. Right? Because Proudhon does not want to strengthen the state at all. Right? He's an anarchist. He doesn't even want a democratic state. He wants no state. And yet, Marx is saying it will lead to that. Right? That's why the state becomes a kind of symptomatic index of whether the problem is actually being overcome. As long as there's a state, that's why the critique of the growth program, you know, that's why he attacks the Lassallian notion of a free state. It's like, as long as there's a state, there's no freedom. I mean, essentially, what you get, Marxism versus anarchism is very simple, which is that the anarchists think you can abolish the state now. Marxists think you can't abolish the state now because of capitalism.
And,
right.
Then,
and then anarchists don't recognize capitalism. But their view is like a pre-capitalist view.
But what you were saying about Proudhon is like the Proudhonian program would just establish the...
It would spontaneously...
The proletariat?
Yeah, it would do the opposite of what Proudhon thinks. Because it would... It
but
would,
which is what, like... So, like, what's the difference between that and Marx and, like, a Marxist program in that case?
There is no difference. Marx doesn't have a unique program. He appropriates the program of the other socialists and just raises the historical self-awareness of how you're pushing up against the limits of these perspectives. He doesn't, I mean, there's never a unique formulation by Marx. He either takes from the Chartists or from Proudhon or from LaSalle or from Bakunin. He takes from all of them.
That's why the event of 1848 is actually a change for him, because it is the entry of the working class into party politics.
Yeah.
And already you have people that go into the legislature and are making demands, and they're marginalized and actually constitute the opposition as they do so.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, Carlos has a question.
Okay. How would you relate the flirting of LaSalle with Bismarck and the idea of organizing the working class as subjects and not as objects? Does it ignore the transformation of the conditions of workers and focuses only on the democratic struggle and not its connection to the contradiction of capital? Yeah, I mean, I'd say that that's exactly right. Meaning that what LaSalle doesn't recognize, what the LaSallians don't recognize, is that as citizens, the workers are in a self-contradictory position. In other words, to get back to the next question, right, it's like subject-object of history. Meaning it's not, you're either a subject or you're an object. You're either a political actor or you're an economic cog in the machine. Right? It's not an either or. So again, the problem with LaSalle is that it's one-sided. And his flirtation with Bismarck doesn't damn him. Right? It's not like that's the crime. It's rather, inevitably, he's going to flirt with Bismarck, given his point of view. It's a natural outcome of his point of view that he's going to say, oh, well, actually, political enfranchisement, that could be giving everyone the vote, or it could be just to get the state to act in the workers' interests. Like, you could just skip the election part and go straight to the chancellor and say, okay, defend us against the capitalists, as if we elected you.
I mean, isn't it the positing of the universal interest as the citizen as opposed to the worker?
It is. The LaSallian view, and in some ways the Proudhonian view also, because he also is opposed to a kind of corporatist view on the part of the working class. I would say that, yeah, it that basically what you get is a kind of LaSalle's opposed to the stunted character of just acting in your economic interest. What Marx says in the inaugural speech to the First International is that while the economic self-organization of the working class is minuscule in comparison to capitalism as a whole, it's still significant. It's significant as part and parcel of the working class's political education. Right, this is why later Luxembourg can call the unions the school of the struggle for socialism. It's where you go to school, like, you know, to learn about society. But it's just school. It's not like the real thing. Right. So again, it's the difference between learning in school and learning on the job. Right. It's not like learning in school means you don't have to learn on the job. So in this respect, right, the LaSallian view is that it's sectoral, it's not universal, right? But also partial, meaning that it's looking at society as if it were an economic machine, rather than, for LaSalle, I mean, he really is a kind of political ontologist. He thinks that humans achieve their dignity as human beings in politics. So it's, you know, that to act in your economic interest is itself demeaning. So it's, what LaSalle flirting with Bismarck, why it replicates Proudhon flirting with Bonaparte, is the frustration, meaning there's a kind of impasse that's experienced. And that impasse then seeks a way out, and the way out seems to be go to the Bonapartist. And we see that today, right? We need a political revolution, so run a candidate in the Democratic Party. Right, go to the source.
Who will only end up strengthening the Democratic
Party? Yeah, like, you know, because it's understood, actually, to build a new party would be, like, extremely difficult and maybe impossible. And so let's just take advantage of the fact that the Democratic Party is an empty shell anyway. Except it isn't an empty shell, as it turns out. But anyway, we'll still go there.
Roth Nader had an even more desperate response after sort of offering himself as a presidential candidate in multiple elections. He wrote this book called Only the Super Rich Can Save Us.
Oh, sure.
Trump.
George Soros. Bill and Melinda Gates.
Yeah,
absolutely.
He imagines
the Socialist Party will have to get bankrolled by these people. Definitely. You have to sit down with George Soros and say, okay, it's not going to be like Hungary. Well, I mean, I hope you guys know the Bolsheviks were bankrolled by rich people. Of course. Of course. It's the only way.
This is backtracking a little bit, but when you were talking about, like, the task of appropriating capital for, like, Bonapartism versus, like, the working class, sort of, like, you said that Bonapartism and its approach to that task is limited in, like, approaching it politically, whereas, like, the working class is limited in approaching it economically. Where would the political approach sort of, like, differ between
the two? I mean, what I'd say is that, okay, so the state takes over. In Bonapartism, the state takes over what the capitalists as a class can't do for themselves. So it takes the form of, like, crony capitalism.
Mm-hmm.
So the thing with crony capitalism, it's the who-whom question. Meaning, is Bonaparte using the capitalists, or are the capitalists using Bonaparte? Because, of course, each side thinks that it's using the other side. The only way that it can work is if both sides are right. Meaning that the capitalists are using Bonaparte. Bonaparte is their creature. However, he's also using them. And so that's why it becomes this insoluble dilemma. So that's why, you know, when I assert what I do and Mike McNair freaks out and he says, well, no, you know, it's still a bourgeois state. The capitalists are still calling the shots. Really? You know, there's a question of, you know, do the capitalists ever call the shots? Call the shots in what arena? How are they calling the shots? Meaning, you know, in terms of state policy, is it always the case that capitalists need a strong state to do what they want in order for capitalism to work? Yes and no, right? So again, it becomes this question of, has Bonaparte compromised himself to the capitalist class, or has the capitalist class subordinated itself to Bonaparte? I think there's a reason why Marx chooses rhetorically to say that the capitalist class has subordinated itself to Bonaparte. Not happily, but they've done it. They weren't happy to do it, but they had to do it. And again, you can see it as, well, they had to do it because they were threatened by the working class. Except they weren't. The working class was defeated. The working class was disorganized. So it's not that the capitalists had to go running to Bonaparte because the workers were threatening them. No. It's a deeper problem than that. Really, it has to do with the disorganization of capitalist civil society. That's the real issue. It's the fact that the market mechanism doesn't work, which, again, McNair thinks the market mechanism has never worked since the Middle Ages. No, it specifically doesn't work in a new way after the Industrial Revolution. Again, because it's not that there have always been booms and busts. It's that Marx understands booms and busts after the Industrial Revolution to have a different reason than market chaos. It's the undermining of the value of labor that causes the boom-bust cycle. It's not market chaos. Because there's always been market chaos, yes. Markets always have chaos. But
that's the distribution critique.
That's the distribution critique, right. In other words, that would just be, well, the market is inadequate as a distributing mechanism. But for Marx, it's not a crisis of distribution, it's a crisis of production,
right?
And so is Marx right? Maybe he's right, maybe he's not. But if he's right,
crisis of production in the sense of the undervaluing of labor.
Yes, the value of labor in society, right? That this form of production experiences a crisis. What I'm saying is Marx could be right or wrong, but one has to understand that his political conclusions derive from his understanding of the Industrial Revolution.
Can you explain a little bit further the connection between the undervaluing of labor and the boom-bust cycle, like how the two are interconnected?
Well, you know that a lot of Marxists get hung up on the falling rate of profit, tendency of the rate of profit to fall. That's part of it, but it's only part of it. Marx thinks it's a problem of accumulation. That's why Rosa Luxemburg goes back and says, well, okay, Marx tries to deal with this in volume two of Capital, so I'm going to try my hand at it, right, the accumulation of capital. Meaning that the tendency of the rate of profit to fall is a problem of capital accumulation, on the one hand. On the other hand, Adam Smith also had a notion of the falling rate of profit. Except he saw it positively, whereas the experience of it after the Industrial Revolution is negative, meaning the falling rate of profit produces crises, whereas for Adam Smith, the falling rate of profit makes capitalism work and work better, meaning that if profits are low and wages are high, that's good for producing wealth. It's only after the Industrial Revolution that what Smith thought would have been good for wealth production becomes a crisis of value, and you get the destruction of means of production. You get factories standing idle, workers being thrown out of work. So it has the opposite effect that Smith expected. Smith thought that you keep the system going, and then you get under-consumptionism. In other words, Keynes basically comes back at it as a kind of neo-Smithian, meaning that the variable of capital investment doesn't really change that much. The only thing that changes is wages. And so when capitalism comes into crisis, you want to boost demand. So you want to boost consumption, which is essentially the Adam Smith view. Now, the advantage of Keynes over Mike McNair is that Keynes acknowledges the Industrial Revolution. In other words, he knows that this is a new problem. In other words, he's a post-Marxist. He's not a pre-Marxist the way McNair is. He's a post-Marxist, meaning he thinks that Marx is onto something, but sees Marx more in continuity with Adam Smith and sees it as like a modern economic problem. And now the state can do things that it couldn't do in the 19th century. boost consumption in a way that in the 19th century its ability to do so was limited, et cetera, et cetera. Earlier you stated, this is from Daniel, earlier you stated that Bonapartism is political authority over capitalism. Latin America in the 70s and 80s, revolutionism resorted to political nationalism as a rallying call with funding from the Soviet Union. In light of your definition of Bonapartism, has Stalinism Bonapartism substantively changed in these instances? I would say no. I would say no. I would say, I'll just give the negative version. The negative version is that Stalinism is Bonapartism, and that Soviet supporting a third world regime doesn't do anything to make that regime better. Right? Because the Soviet Union supported a lot of really nasty regimes, like Ba'athist Iraq. Like, not only did it support the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, but it also supported some really nasty regimes. And so it doesn't actually change the character. Again, it's a form of opportunism. And one would have to explain Daniel Ortega today versus Daniel Ortega in the 80s, because today he's just a reactionary nationalist. In the 80s, he appeared to be some kind of a socialist. But he's the same. He is the same. So Stalinism doesn't really change anything.
You were cautioning me earlier, I think, rightly against centralizing nationalism as a response to the colonial situation. I think it's also worth pointing out that during the Cold War, the post-World War II years, especially at first, I think in the late 40s, the U.S. also supported nationalism in certain ways against the economic blocs of Britain.
Absolutely.
Right? So it was kind of a geostrategic interest thing of reconstituting capitalism on the basis of nationalism in those countries.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Certainly. And so what I'd say about the Wilsonian settlement, the desired Wilsonian settlement, which actually doesn't really get realized until after World War II, but begins to be realized, meaning the protectorates are not meant to be permanent. The U.S. is pushing for decolonization all the way through this period. Now, you know, what I'd say about that in terms of the limitations of that is that the Wilsonian system is just a series of more or less failed states. It looks like it's only after the collapse of the Soviet Union that you have failed states, but really it's failed states all the way through, really. It's not like, you know, and again, there are moments, right? It's like the Mexican Revolution. Right. In other words, it looks like Latin America in the 20s and 30s might achieve parity with Europe and the United States. It does. Yeah, these are not abjectly poor countries. Like Argentina in the 1920s is not an abjectly poor country. It's not. It, in some ways, it really isn't in many respects all the way up till the present, but the problems that it faces accumulate over time. So you get certain kind of problem. And after World War II, you get a problem starting in the 70s. You know, certainly the 30s hit Latin America pretty hard. The Great Depression hit Latin America pretty hard. So it's, again, yes, the U.S. has an agenda, but it's, you know, the Marxist conception of capitalist policy is that it's hopeless. Right? It's not like, oh, if the U.S. gets its way, it somehow solves the problem. Doesn't, not even for the US. Right? That's why the idea of inter-imperialist rivalry is so useless. Because it turns it into a zero-sum game. You have winners and losers, as if there were winners. There aren't. At least not in the long array. We'll get to some of that language when Marx describes, he takes a kind of retrospective view of the Second Empire from the standpoint of Paris Commune. He basically says local world was the Second Empire. So again, to say that it was a period of capitalist modernization and of national development is to ignore the fact that it was 20 years of France being ripped off by the rest of the world, which is what Marx points out. In other words, you can't actually say that what Louis Bonaparte accomplished was the capitalist development of France, because in fact he acted against it as much as he facilitated it. You know, it's a fiasco. Which again, from a capitalist perspective, it's because, oh, it's an irresponsible dictatorship. If it had only been a capitalist democracy, it wouldn't have been a fiasco. As if capitalist democracies aren't fiascos all the time, you know? Yeah, but again, it's convenient to say, well, it's a fiasco because it's irresponsible government.
This relates to the way that, like, failed development attempts in the post-war era are attempted to be understood, like the stages of development idea.
And also that it's blamed, like, if you look at third world developmental states, what people will say is they failed because they were dictatorships. No, they were dictatorships because they were failures. That's why they're dictatorships, because in the midst of a fiasco, you need a dictator to keep it from flying completely apart. They didn't fail because they were dictatorships. They were dictatorships because they were failures. That's the point. That's why, you know, Marxists don't hope for fiasco. Like, it's not like we're waiting for the next economic crisis to hit, because it's not going to be good. And, you know, the revolutions that have taken place have not been, you know, like the revolutions of 1917 to 1919 were not at an economic crisis. They were at a political crisis. They were at a war. And so, again, though we wouldn't wish either for a political fiasco, meaning we don't want an economic crisis, but we also don't want World War III. That's not where our hopes lie. That's why the Trotsky formulation is so very, very important to keep in mind, which is that this perspective of proletarian socialism is a hypothesis, and it's never happened yet. It's never happened yet.
It's the Marxist wager.
It's the Marxist wager, instead of the Stalin wager. It's the Marxist wager. Meaning that, you know, God may or may not exist, right? Socialism may or may not be possible, but we may as well try. Because we certainly have enough history to show what not trying amounts to. Although the liberals can always come back and say, well, look what trying amounts to.
Right.
Right. But the thing is, if the Bolsheviks hadn't taken power in Russia, you would have just had a fascist dictatorship. You would have had the Holocaust 20 years earlier. Why? Because World War I was already bad. All right, on that note, let's adjourn.